This episode is a direct sequel of PS2J 162, Silent Hill Part 1. So if you missed that, please go back and listen or else you'll be very lost. Welcome to Press Start to Join episode 168. I'm Josh.
And I'm Alan. Previously on the history of Silent Hill Part 1, we talked about the conception of the Silent Hill games.
And now we're covering the last of the main titles, spin-offs, and some more.
Let's hope we don't get cancelled as we go back to Silent Hill.
As I said briefly in the intro, that this is a continuation of PS2J 162, so if you missed that, please go back and listen to part one, because we cover a lot of stuff. We talk about the first five titles in the main series, we talk briefly about the two movies, and I'm not getting into the films anymore.
Okie dokie.
2008, Silent Hill Homecoming. It came out for PlayStation 3, Xbox 360, and Windows. This is the sixth installment of the Silent Hill series, and it's developed by Double Helix Games.
Ooh.
It seems that Team Silent isn't developing games anymore.
I miss you, Team Silent.
They made really good games.
Well, Team Silent had it all psychological, and then every other Silent Hill is like, oh, you know those set pieces that were psychological in that one game?
Yeah.
Let's use them in everything.
Yeah, it's a shame they kind of missed the point on that. So, Homecoming follows the journey of Alex Shepard, a soldier returning from war, to his hometown of Shepherd's Glen, where he finds the town in disarray and his younger brother missing. As he continues his search to find his younger brother, he discovers more about the Order, a cult, as well as the town's history and his own past.
Is the town's history that it is secretly Silent Hill?
I don't know. The player assumes the role Alex Shepard, a special forces soldier who returns home from an overseas tour of duty to find that his father and younger brother are missing.
Oh, shit.
And his mother has gone catatonic.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, he's got a rough life. Alex begins to search for his brother, leading him to Silent Hill after searching his hometown of Shepherd's Glen.
Oh.
Yeah. The overall gameplay is similar to past entries. As Alex, you explore various environments and locales, searching for clues to advance the plot. You can find photographs, drawings, other items, and he puts them all in his journal, and you can later look at them.
Mm-hmm.
To assist the player, Alex will turn his head towards items and clues to inform the player that the object may be picked up.
Neat.
Other recurring items include, like, weapons and ammunition, which will actually glow to have a visual cue for the player to pick them up. And there's health drinks. Puzzle elements also play a part of the game.
Just a little more
information. Like I said, Alex's journal, you can look back at it and refer to the photographs and other items that can help you decipher, like, puzzles and keypad entries.
Fancy.
For the first time in the series, the player may select responses when engaging in dialogue with other characters that you encounter in the game. So it sort of affects the way the player sees the plot unfold. In addition to exploration, combat is another major element to the gameplay, and the player must fight the various monsters that appear. In contrast, the more naive everyman protagonists of the previous games, the combat in Homecoming takes into account Alex's experience as a soldier.
Okay.
The player is able to perform light and heavy attacks, or mix them to perform combinations.
Ooh.
They may also perform a variety of finishing moves that ensures that the monsters are dead. A gameplay mechanic first featured in a rudimentary form in Silent Hill Origins.
Oh, shit.
Attacking enemies also leaves wounds in them that will match the motion carried out by Alex inflicting the attack.
Fancy.
In terms of controlling Alex, the player may also perform new maneuvers such as targeting the enemy before attacking them, dodging enemy attacks, and performing counterattacks.
Hmm.
As well as melee weapons, pistols, rifles, and shotguns are available as firearms, which can all be upgraded to stronger versions later in the game. Firearm handling is also rendered in a more realistic manner, with Alex having to shoulder long guns and suffering the aim effects of, like, recoil. In addition to changes in combat, and unlike previous entries in the series, the player is also able to fully control and rotate the camera as they choose. One analog stick controls the player movement, and the other controls the camera.
Hmm. Yeah, that is kind of weird.
Yeah, it's weird because the previous games were third person, but in a cinematic angle, while this is actually a full controllable third person.
Hmm. That's got to take out some of the horror of the whole situation.
Yeah, it would. Chief designer of Silent Hill Homecoming, Masashi Tsuboyama, announced the game's development in a 2004 interview with Eurogamer. in which he debunked previous internet rumors that it would be called Shadows of the Past. Around 2 years later, an interview with composer Akira Yamaoka revealed more information. He hinted that they hoped to carry on plans for earlier Silent Hill platforms, and that the team were creating a title in the idea of Fear in the Daylight, with similar psychological roots to Silent Hill 2.
Cool.
At E3 2007, a new teaser trailer was displayed by Konami that revealed the title of the game to be Silent Hill 5, and that the game would be released for PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. Further to this trailer, Konami executives also revealed that the developer would not in fact be Team Silent as in previous iterations, but like Silent Hill Origins, it would be made by a Western developer.
We all know how that turned out. Decent.
Double Helix drew inspiration not only from past installments in the game series, but also from the first Silent Hill movie adaptation.
Oh, okay, that's a little bit of an Ouroboros there.
This is most evident in the transition from the normal world to the other world, where there's ripping effects that basically match what you see in the movie.
Oh yeah, that is right out of the movie.
Other similarities from the same source includes the reaction of the nurses to light, the bug-like creature seen in the movie, and the Pyramid Head rendition, also known as the Boogeyman in the game.
Yeah.
Homages to previous games in the series include a reference to the long-running joke that the lead character placing their hand in a toilet bowl to retrieve items.
Okay. Yeah, it's like the spittoons in West of Loathing.
Homecoming had difficulties passing censors in some countries before it could go on sale. The Australian Classification Board, the Office of Film and Literature Classification, refused to classify the game due to impact violence and excessive blood effects.
Oh, jeez.
The objectionable scenes included various body parts being drilled into, as well as a bisection of a character by an enemy.
Oh, no.
This had the effect of banning the game for sale in the country, and representatives for publisher Atari mentioned that they would be asking Konami to tone down the violence to allow the game to receive the needed MA-15 rating for sale to be permitted in 2009.
It sucks to live in Australia if you like video games. That's what I've learned.
It's rough.
Yeah.
The German version of the game was also postponed. It needed huge cuts to make it past censors.
Really?
Oh yeah. The uncensored version was rejected by the Entertainment Software Self-Regulation Body, with a German word I can't even begin to pronounce.
Okay.
The game was resubmitted after being altered in the same way as the Australian version and received the highest rating possible. An 18 plus.
Jeez.
And you know what? I'm going to message you the German name for the Entertainment Software Regulation Body.
The German word? Sure. Unterhalten Software Selbst Control.
Yeah, I had no chance with that.
Yeah.
With no German experience, I just put it in brackets and found the English translation for it to use in the podcast.
Unterhalten Software Selbst Control. So, literally, it's like under stop software something control. I'm not sure what Selbst is.
Well, it's directly Entertainment Software Self-Regulation Body, so.
Oh, yeah, Selbst Control, self-regulation. Okay, that makes sense.
On November 19th, 2010, the local court in Frankfurt confiscated all Xbox 360 versions imported from the UK, because these were uncensored, for they violated the representation of violence law.
Brutal.
Effectively banning it for sale within Germany.
Brutal.
Homecoming's average at Metacritic is 71 out of 100 for the PS3 version, 70 out of 100 for the 360 version, and 64 out of 100 for the PC version.
It's not great.
Silent Hill Shattered Memories 2009 for Wii, PlayStation 2, PlayStation Portable.
Yeah, that Wii version, huh?
Yeah, that's a thing. This is the seventh title in the series. It retains the premise of the original game, Harry Mason's quest to find his missing daughter in the fictitious American town of Silent Hill, but it is set in a different fictional universe, has a different plot, and altered characters alongside new ones. Five endings are available. Gameplay takes place in two parts, a framing first-person psychotherapy session and an over-the-shoulder perspective of Harry's journey through Silent Hill, which is periodically interrupted by the occurrence of a shift into an alternate dimension. Answers given to the psychological tests in the therapy session affect various gameplay elements in Harry's journey.
Oh, that's where Until Dawn got it.
Yeah, maybe. Shattered Memories divides its gameplay between two different settings. The first section is set in a psychotherapist's office, and the second in Silent Hill. In the first section, the player interacts with Dr. Michael Kaufman, a therapist, and it's all in first-person perspective. The player responds to Kaufman's questions and completes a psychological test, fills in a questionnaire, or colors pictures. The player's responses to these tests alters aspects of gameplay in the second setting.
Neat.
Including the available areas, the physical appearance and behavior of characters encountered, and the physical appearance of monsters. Shattered Memories returns to Kaufman's office periodically throughout the game. In the second setting, you play as Harry Mason in a third-person view as you search for your daughter in the snowy town of Silent Hill. Harry's equipped with a smartphone and a flashlight. He can use the phone to check his location on a GPS system, take photographs, and make telephone calls.
Nice.
Moving to certain spots with high interference, represented by a lot of radio noise, or by taking pictures of spots where shadowy figures can be seen, unlock various text and voicemail messages that expand the story and occasionally provide clues. To view the details of these various documents, the player can zoom in on them. The game also alters details of gameplay based on what the player views.
Cool. That's kind of neat.
Throughout his journey, Harry encounters puzzles such as mechanisms, reward you either with a key to progress throughout the game or a bonus memento. In the Wii version, the Wii remote is used for puzzle solving and to control the flashlight and cell phone.
Yeah, I think I saw some gameplay of it where like voicemail messages were coming out of the Wiimote speaker and it just sounded awful because it's a bad speaker.
Yeah, it sucks. And they add that effect to make it sound like it's coming out of a phone anyways.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty rough.
The game occasionally shifts into an icy alternate dimension called Nightmare, where there's hostile monsters. To escape this dimension, Harry must find a predetermined exit while avoiding the wandering creatures which chase him upon detection.
Oh, jeez.
Unlike previous installments in the series, there is no combat element to the gameplay. Harry is weaponless.
Oh, what?
For the entire duration of the game, he can only run, hide, slow the monsters down by knocking down objects to block their path, throw creatures off of them whenever they latch on, and temporarily ward them off by picking up and using flares that are found lying on the ground.
Oh, there's some survival horror for you.
Yeah, they made this one different. His running speed and health decrease every time the monsters grab him.
Oh, crap.
In contrast to previous installments of the series, which featured various types of monsters, Shattered Memories features only one type of humanoid monster.
Oh, weird.
Whose physical appearance changes in response to the player's actions inside and outside the Nightmare Realm, including the responses to Kaufman's psychological tests.
Okay.
Plans for a Silent Hill remake, and speculation of a possible remake beyond the Silent Hill film, were circulating as early as 2006. The idea of a remake was also considered early in the development of the prequel game Silent Hill Origins. Climax Studios, the developer of Silent Hill Origins, developed Shattered Memories with a development team made of over 55 members and supporting network of over 90 artists.
Wow.
With the completion of Origins, for which they attempted to closely replicate the atmosphere and gameplay elements of Silent Hill, Climax Studios wanted to create a different horror game.
Okay.
Because of the 10th anniversary of the first Silent Hill, Konami thought that this time was ideal to revisit the game. Climax Studios saw the then newly introduced Wii platform as a way to reach a wider range of gamers, especially outside of Japan. No Silent Hill title has been exclusively released on a Nintendo platform. The developers wanted to use the Wii remote to incorporate the gameplay elements of the flashlight and radio static.
That makes sense.
And to please fans of the series and to bring in new ones, they decided to reimagine the setting and characters, such as Dahlia, who was changed from a haggard old woman who led the town's cult into a physically attractive young woman.
So it's the same, except they changed the places, the people, the things that happen. Otherwise, exactly the same.
Yeah, totally. Just, you know, a reimagining. So, same-ish?
Yeah.
Early in the game's development, some team members visited a psychiatrist for research. The use of ice as a visual theme originated partly because the developers wanted to create an other world for the game, like the previous games in the series, and snowfall was common for the northeastern and midwestern United States, where Silent Hill would be located. Falling snow was used to limit the player's visibility and build an atmosphere of dread.
Oh, yeah. less dark and goopy.
Writer Sam Barlow explained the system, "Ultimately, every little thing you do in the game or piece of content you interact with can be assigned a little personality score." This is all added into a very classical psychometric profile of your personality that can be mapped onto research.
That does make sense.
The opening questionnaire has little significance on the player's profile, capturing multiple variations of gameplay elements for submission to the Entertainment Software Rating Board proved to be difficult, according to the game's producer, Tom Hewlett. Loading times were eliminated from the game to maintain a sense of immersion for the player. The developers felt that creating another game in the series with the same style of gameplay had limited potential. In an attempt to imbue the game with the feel of a horror film where the protagonist is a regular person and the antagonist is powerful, they avoided the common survival horror gameplay feature of a player character who is skilled in the use of weapons.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, they generated an unarmed player character and examined the survival horror gameplay staple of difficult combat and sluggish opponents, inspired by zombie films and modeled after the video games Alone in the Dark and Resident Evil.
Yeah, it's more of a feeling of helplessness. You're not armed, you're not ready, you just need to run.
Yeah, and they actually did a lot to get the chase sequences right. They also analyzed around 50 chase sequences from various films, including horror films, and the structure of slasher films, which is a powerful and intelligent antagonist pursuing the protagonist.
That's pretty cool.
The developers drew inspiration from common childhood nightmares about running away from an unknown threat, and decided to incorporate the intelligent enemy capable of trailing and outrunning the protagonist.
Oh, jeez.
The chase sequences were also designed to invoke a brief sense of tension and fright for the player.
Mm-hmm.
Although the developers did not want to prolong the tension with constant presence of monsters, and they were concerned that this would become overwhelming and spoil the player's immersion of the game and your interest in the story. The constant presence of monsters was also made to be irrelevant to shattered memories. Director Mark Simmons said, "This Harry Mason is not a guy who is constantly under attack from monsters. It is not a story of surviving the zombie apocalypse."
Yeah, it's just constant. As soon as the tension becomes constant, you get used to it. You're like, okay, well, now what?
Yeah, they keep it fresh by saving it.
Yeah.
According to producer Tom Hewlett, the number of pre-ordered copies of Silent Hill Shattered Memories looked very good. In March 2010, the game placed 5th on the list for top 40 best-selling PS2 video games in the UK and 11th on the corresponding list for Wii games. However, Nintendo World Report stated that the sales of the game were low. The game eventually broke even with the help of the PS2 port.
Oh no.
Selling an estimated 440,000 copies, Metacritic has the game at a 79 out of 100.
That's not bad. That's actually higher than average for the later in the series Silent Hill games.
Silent Hill Downpour, 2012, PlayStation 3, Xbox 360. The 8th installment in the Silent Hill video game series. Downpour was released March 2012. It's set in the series multiverse, which consists of a reality and an alternate dimension, whose form is based in the town of Silent Hill. So this one's a little more amorphous, I guess.
Neat. it takes place in a thing that could be a lot of things.
They call it Silent Hill every time.
Okay.
Downpour centers on Murphy Pendleton, a prisoner who enters the town, periodically entering the alternate dimension and unlocks personal repressed memories.
Oh, shit.
It's, again, third-person view and can be played in stereoscopic 3D.
That would be weird.
Yeah.
Is it just like red blue or?
I assume it would be like red. Oh yeah, red blue, red green, whatever.
Yeah, whatever just the color glasses instead of like fancy TV.
That's usually what I think stereoscopic is.
Maybe I don't know. I mean, stereo just means like two. So.
So if you've played Downpour in stereoscopic 3D, let us know.
Yeah, I'm legitimately curious.
Gameplay focuses on exploration, puzzle solving and combat. Side quests involving the inhabitants of the town appear in this game. The player can shape Murphy's character through several moral choices presented throughout the game, by allowing him to act on or refuse opportunities to save different NPCs.
Hmm.
For combat, he can only carry one melee weapon, which will gradually deteriorate and break. Firearms and ammunition are scarce, and Murphy has a difficult time aiming them. As his health declines... Oh, sorry. Yeah.
I mean, like, good, because Silent Hill isn't about guns. It's not Resident Evil.
Yeah, it was just the one that had the ex-soldier.
Yeah.
So as his health declines, his clothes take on a more bloodied and torn appearance. The game features a real-time weather system, and which rainfall will periodically occur, and during that time, monsters appear more frequently, and they're stronger.
Hands downpour. Neat.
In April 2010, Konami screened the first trailer of Downpour at a conference in San Francisco, and confirmed that the game was, at the time, being developed by a Czech developer called Varda Games, Vatra Games, and was given the working title Silent Hill 8. At E3 2010, the 16th edition of E3, they focused on... Oh, sorry. Yeah. An online profile by Vatra, by its game talent agency, Digital Development Management, led to speculation that Downpour would be a first-person shooter, which would have been a dramatic shift from the usual gameplay.
No kidding, that would have been weird. Might have fit better with the 3D, though. Kind of make it like a first-person VR asterisk.
Yeah. According to Brian Gomez, the design director for this game, the history of the town Brno, the home of the Vatra studio, led the developers to having an affinity for the macabre. Mm-hmm. A huge gorge nearby is literally translated as Stepmother Abyss. It was the it was the inspiration for the Devil's Pit aerial tram. It's a level in that in this game.
Hmm.
The soundtrack is industrial, and
always good.
Downpour soundtrack belongs to the industrial music genre, but to a lesser extent in comparison to previous games in the series, which all had more prominent use of such music. Downpour emphasizes sound by organic objects, so more like a stomp. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's definitely like a lot of the earlier stuff was more like industrial machinery sounding instead of organic.
Yeah. Downpour received mixed or average reviews according to the review aggregator Metacritic. In general, critics were split on the story and atmosphere, and then sort of criticized the combat and technical performance.
Brutal.
It got a 64 out of 100 for PS3, and the 360 version got a 68 out of 100 on Metacritic.
I wonder what was different.
It seemed a little more open world. You're doing quests for people?
No, I mean, like, between the two platforms. I'm always curious, like, is one a port of the other? Is there...
I'd say the difference would be what people are expecting. I'd say PlayStation people expect a little bit more adventure games, while Xbox fans are looking for more of the action, usually combat stuff.
Yeah, that could be.
And Downpour has been the last installment for the franchise, the main line.
Ooh, that's rough.
Yeah. So, that being the last main game, there has been several...
Spinoffs
and such.
Cool.
So, Silent Hill, the arcade from 2007. You play as two different characters, Eric and Tina. You've entered Silent Hill and must battle monsters while uncovering the mystery behind Eric's nightmares about a girl on a steamship. And the arcade has a multiplayer element where the player can choose to be either Eric or Tina, and the second person can drop in, drop out.
Oh, neat.
Seems sort of House of the Dead-y.
Yeah, that sounds kind of cool.
Yeah. Again, in 2007, Silent Hill The Escape. It's a mobile phone spin-off game. It was first released in Japan in 2007 and then internationally on iOS in 2009. You guide the character through 10 stages by finding a key and opening a locked door. It's played first person, apparently.
Huh, that is a departure.
Yeah, mixed reviews due to lack of storyline and poor execution.
Ooh, so, that's rough.
Yeah. 2012, less of a spinoff, more of a re-release, the Silent Hill HD collection.
Hmm.
It was a re-release of Silent Hill 2 and Silent Hill 3, and it had high-resolution visuals, new sounds, new voices. They added the trophies or achievements for whichever system you're playing on. It had an exclusive option to use the new and old voices, but Silent Hill 3, you could only use the new voice track because there was a bunch of legal issues with the old voices.
Oh, that's rough.
Silent Hill 2 features the main scenario as well as Born from a Wish sub-scenario. For Maria, we talked about it earlier where that was like the greatest hits version. Mm-hmm. It's in this.
That makes sense.
And it's the first time Silent Hill 3 is playable on an Xbox console.
Oh, neat.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the collection got mixed negative reviews due to severe issues with both games, such as severe frame rate problems, lockups, and more.
Oh, ouch.
They patched the PS3 version, but the Xbox 360 version was canceled, and Konami offered refunds to all 360 owners.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Just, oof. That's never good.
No kidding.
Silent Hill Book of Memories 2012 is a game for the Vita.
Oh, neat.
Released in October. It's an RPG, also sort of a spin-off, developed by WayForward Technologies. WayForward is popular for Shantae.
Oh, that's what I'm thinking of, because their name was ringing a bell.
Yeah. Book of Memories utilizes an overhead isometric view and follows a new storyline and features returning creatures from the series universe, as well as a cooperative gameplay, and the first installment in the series to feature multiplayer.
Hmm.
According to series producer Tom Hewlett, Book of Memories gameplay will... he says it will be largely different from the one established in previous installments in the series, focusing on co-op gameplay rather than traditional psychological horror. Way different.
Yeah, no kidding.
So I guess it's like playing Ocarina of Time and then just jumping into Triforce Heroes and being like, what the hell?
Yeah, a little bit of a leap.
They also had a few dropped balls, some canceled games with Silent Hill attached to it.
Oh.
For Nintendo DS, WayForward, the guys who made Book of Memories, the folks who made Book of Memories, worked on a DS title in 2006. It was sort of a one-room prototype where the lead character was assets from Silent Hill 2 before it was all canceled. Renegade Kid patched their DS title, Dementium, The Ward, as a Silent Hill spin-off title. It was rejected by Konami for various reasons involving Konami just not wanting to trust such a small company with their license. Renegade Kid later patched the modified version of Dementium 2, which was also rejected, but Konami just didn't want to enter the DS space with a horror title.
Konami just wanted to be a bunch of dicks over there.
And so Dementium The Ward and Dementium 2 are standalone games by this Renegade Kid.
Good for them. Thing.
And I heard they're cult classic if you like horror games.
Nice.
They're two of nine total M-rated DS games, I think.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Broken Covenant. Before Climax Studios started working on what would become Silent Hill Origins, they originally pitched a different game idea to Konami in 2006. They wanted it to be a PS3 exclusive and proposed it would take place in Arizona and star a protagonist, Father Hector Santos. The priest would have utilized water, a major motif for the game, to perform holy rites and rituals. The proposal never received a green light from Konami, and it was reimagined as the original title called Broken Covenant that was also shelved.
Oh, damn. I was like, that sounds cool. Oh, that could be... No, okay.
Yeah. But it came back to get shelved permanently.
That sucks.
The last sort of one I didn't hear much of is The Box.
Oh.
Silicon Knights, a developer struggling financially after a legal battle with Epic Games, announced the titles in production when the company ceased development in 2012, and one of them was called Silent Hill The Box.
Mm.
But later, it's just known as The Box, which could have been a code name for the title after the publishing deal fell through. For its existence, they released a screenshot of the game, and it was released through computerandvideogames.com.
Oh. Yeah. You know that popular website, computerandvideogames.com?
Yeah, I like to go there after totallynotavirus.org.
And don't forget www.www.com.com.
Yeah. One of the saddest canceled games, Silent Hills.
Oh, yeah, this is a heartbreak and a half.
It would be directed by Hideo Kojima, as well as Guillermo del Toro, and it would be the 9th main installment in the Silent Hill franchise.
Mm-hmm.
Kojima was brought onto the project in September 2012 by Konami. The game was announced in August 2014 through PT, which was short for Playable Teaser, a critically acclaimed demo that was released as a free download for the PlayStation Store. PT, mm-hmm. once you beat it, revealed the involvement of Del Toro, as well as Norman Reedus as the voice, and he also appeared as the protagonist. The game's development was questioned due to rumors surrounding Kojima's work with the completion of Metal Gear Solid V, The Phantom Pain, and his eventual exit from Konami. In 2015, reports surfaced from Del Toro that Silent Hills have just been cancelled, and Konami officially confirming the cancellation shortly after that. A move was negatively received by critics and fans of the franchise.
Well, no kidding. That, I think we actually reported on that in our news episodes. Just, it was a complete shit show between Konami and Kojima.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
So, Kojima, Del Toro, and Reedus eventually teamed up, and they're working on a game, Death Stranding.
Mm-hmm. And which, that looks pretty cool again.
Yeah, it just has one strange Ultra HD trailer, and it's like, I don't know what's going on.
Mm-hmm. It's weird.
So, as I mentioned briefly a second ago, PT was something that sort of took everyone by surprise, and it's left a mark on gaming. This playable trailer has left a mark on gaming.
Absolutely. Like, I wish that they hadn't removed it, because it's a cool-looking game, and I missed an opportunity to get it, and I could have sold my PlayStation for a lot of money with it on there.
So, for anyone who missed out, it's a first-person psychological horror game developed by Kojima Productions under the pseudonym 7780S, I guess, Studios. Published by Konami, the game is directed and designed by Kojima with Guillermo del Toro. It just came out for PS4 on August 12th, 2014, as a free download on the PlayStation Network. It was an interactive teaser for the game Silent Hills, and after its cancellation, Konami removed PT from the PlayStation Store and eliminated reinstalling the game. And that decision spawned tons of criticism, as people wanted to be playing this game.
No kidding. Like, it's a good standalone game in and of itself.
Yeah. So, PT received critical acclaim for its direction, visuals, story complexity, and its supernatural horror tension build. And it was both sort of criticized and acclaimed for its puzzles and the solutions to them.
Yeah, it was pretty asinine.
So, unlike the third-person games of previous Silent Hills, PT was first-person, and it sort of centers on an unknown protagonist who you control, and you just wake up in this haunted suburban house and experience the supernatural events around you.
Mm-hmm.
Available areas to explore in the game consist of an L-shaped corridor with two rooms adjacent to it, a bathroom, and a staircase, which lead to the room in which the player starts a loop. And that became its own genre as looping horror games.
Oh, absolutely. It's so unsettling to go through a doorway where you know what's behind it and it's different.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's so brain-breaking.
So, in this game, you're probably thinking, oh, you can do so much. All you can do is walk and zoom in.
Mm-hmm.
and to progress, you must investigate the frightening events and solve cryptic puzzles. Each time a loop is successfully completed, changes appear in the corridor, allowing the player to encounter the hostile ghost named Lisa. If she catches you, you have a random chance of triggering a jump scare when turning the camera, and you're just sent back to the beginning of the current loop. After you solve the final puzzle, a cryptic and unrevealed puzzle that allows the player to escape, it reveals that PT is playable trailer, and then it says, like, Silent Hills, directed by... It says, like, the announcement of Silent Hills, and directed by Hideo Kojima, Guillermo del Toro, and protagonist portrayed by Norman Reedus, which yeah, is... And it, yeah,
they did the whole reveal of, like, Silent Hill.
Zzz, spooky.
The S just, like, fades in afterwards, and it's like, oh...
So PT was designed for players to take at least a week to complete, and Kojima intended the puzzles to be very enigmatic and difficult. Mm-hmm. Despite his efforts, a few gamers reported finishing the game within hours of the release, which really surprised him.
Because of course they did, they're gamers.
Yeah. He intended PT to be a mystery in order to make it a more frightening experience, because you just downloaded this thing called PT. Mm-hmm. There's little, if not cryptic, information given in the game that these few events take place, and there are some clues on how to solve puzzles. Like, it's very strange. Like, you don't know you can interact with anything, and then you can sometimes. It's weird.
Well, yeah, like, the only thing you can do is, like, zoom in on something, and then stuff happens to it, kind of thing.
Yeah,
That's your interaction.
So he chose the corridor as the setting to because, as opposed to like a ruin, because he wanted the teaser to emotionally affect the player, regardless of your cultural background.
Hmm.
So Kojima elaborated that PT and Silent Hills would have no canonical or direct relation, and that Silent Hills would have been enhanced by the elements that were never in PT, and it was sort of based on his concept of PT, like, is based on horror films and other media that he found frightening.
Oh yeah.
When he was creating the game, he refrained from using graphic violence to build up suspense, as he felt too many horror games rely on this trope. He wanted
It's the polar opposite of The Evil Within.
Yeah, yes.
There's like no physical horror to it. It's all psychological and situational.
Like
a bit supernatural.
The first time you look, you go around the corner and the light's out, you like crap your pants.
Yeah.
And there's just nothing. They do so much nothing that it makes you afraid of the nothing they're doing.
Definitely. The horror is so pervasive and looming, and you just walk through and you're constantly being slowly squished down by the terror of something eventually happening.
Kojima said he wanted to elicit a more genuine, thoughtful, permeating type of fear, which he got.
Absolutely.
PT was announced at Gamescom 2014 as a demo and released August 2014. And instead of formally announcing the game, this release was their sort of secret announcement.
Mm-hmm.
And is released in August, and then in September 2014, Sony announced during its pre-Tokyo Game Show press conference that PT was downloaded over 1 million times.
Wouldn't doubt it.
Oh, really good for free.
Yeah, no kidding.
Journalists have expressed confusion about whether the game should be described as a teaser, a video game, or a demo. Despite an ongoing debate, the game won awards for Best Trailer, while it also won Game of the Month and Best Horror Game of the Year awards. While naming PT as an honorable mention for Best Trailer, Marty Silva from IGN felt PT was more of a interactive experimental film/puzzle game. Demo is one of the most common descriptions of the game. GameSpot was reluctant to categorize it as this, though. Despite it being called a demo for Silent Hills, there's no evidence that this is going to be part of Silent Hills. aside from the reveal at the end, and Kojima himself said that it wasn't a demo of Silent Hills, it's just a teaser in a tweet.
Yeah, you said earlier that Kojima was saying that none of this was going to appear in Silent Hills. It was just like, this is the atmosphere you can expect. Have fun.
Yeah, it's so weird. It's like, here's our game feel experience.
Yeah.
Christopher Grant from Polygon said PT is mostly like one of Pixar's animated shorts you get to see before a full-length film. Which I think is pretty close to the best description of it.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a short thing that's representative of what could be a whole, but it stands on its own two feet very well.
Mm-hmm. So following the news of the cancellation of Silent Hills, that's when they announced PT would be removed from the network on the 29th of April 2015.
Because they're a bunch of dicks.
Yeah. Originally, it was reported that you could re-download it if you had it in your history, but in May, it was no longer re-downloadable. And the cancellation of the game led to tons of criticism of Konami. Patrick Klepek of Kotaku said, "It's fine Konami doesn't want to make Silent Hills, but the deletion of PT was wrong since the demo had become a part of the gaming culture."
Absolutely.
Nick Robison of Polygon described Konami's removal as the most irresponsible, cowardly decision possible, but the subsequent unavailability made the demo one of the coolest, most fascinating games in the history of our medium.
Yeah, it really added to the mythology of this game. The fact that you can only get it by buying a PS4 from eBay that already has the game installed.
Yeah, after the removal, PS4 consoles were showed up on eBay for upwards of $1,000.
Jesus.
But it was pulled down from eBay. I guess it breaks their terms or whatever.
Oh, it's probably like the whole thing where you can't sell wine. You have to sell a sealed wine bottle, never been opened. And it may or may not contain alcohol.
Yeah, it's similar to when people were selling iPhones that had Flappy Bird on it after Flappy Bird got removed.
You have to sell the device, the container, and then make vague mention that like this thing might be installed on it.
Yeah. Guillermo del Toro intended to be one of the future directors of Silent Hills, commented on the PT's popularity, speculating that people still have a passion for Silent Hill. And I think it's just because they made an amazing game.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Like if PT sucked, it would not have garnered all this attention.
And then later, Resident Evil 7 Biohazard was compared to PT during its announcement because it had like a beginning hour demo in its first-person perspective photorealistic graphics.
Yeah, it's right up there, I'd say. And, oh God, can you imagine PT in VR? Oh, that'd be terrifying.
Yeah, and actually, Jordan Amaro, the level designer of Silent Hills, was responsible for the creation of the Resident Evil 7 design and setting, so.
Yeah, I could see that.
And unfortunately, PT's the last thing we've had about Silent Hill, so.
Yeah, it's been a few years, and Konami's just kind of sitting on that license, doing dick all.
So it definitely ends this two-parter on a sad note, that it's just left in the lurch.
Well, it's left in the lurch, but, I mean, looking back at all the stuff we've talked about, if you want to play some Silent Hill, you're not left wanting. There's a fair bit out there.
And gamers immortalized PT on YouTube, at least, so you can go back and watch it.
Yeah, definitely. Plus, I'm sure there's some kind of ROM or potentially legal way to get it from the internet somehow. That is definitely a legal method, and we're not advocating for illegal methods at all.
Not at all.
No.
Thank you very much for listening.
And thank you for pressing start.